Okay, Alexander, let's talk about something that is close to you, close to your home. Probably affects you. The energy crisis. Can we call it a crisis in the UK? I've actually heard statements from I believe it was Exxon that that said this is not that bad. Then I've heard statements from BP saying this is bad. So what is going on here with this energy crisis? Explain what the crisis is, for lack of a better word.
I mean,
Yeah, crisis. Yeah.
in relation to people, to the people of Britain, this is a crisis. I mean, people might argue that it's not a crisis, but the reality is that if you try and tank up your car at the moment, you can't do so because gas stations just aren't carrying either diesel or petrol. I mean, you just can't find places. I mean, where I live in northwest London, there's all sorts of, my wife is connected to all sorts of WhatsApp groups and internet groups, and people are exchanging tips about, where in London you can find the one gas station where they still have a working pump, and unfortunately there's queues miles long. So, for people like that, it is a crisis. Now, there is a great deal of difficulty, however, understanding quite why we are in this crisis. Now, there is one narrative which is being very zealously promulgated across the media that this is all because there is a massive shortage of drivers, of fuel trucks, and that in fact the refineries are full of petrol and diesel. And that the only reason why there's a shortage like this is because there isn't enough drivers to ship all this fuel to the stations, the gas stations, and that's why it's not getting there. Now, I have a problem with that. I'm sure there is a big element of truth to this, but that doesn't explain why this problem has suddenly flared up so suddenly. And it does seem to me that part of the narrative undoubtedly is being spun by people who don't like Brexit very much, and they're trying to argue that a lot of these drivers are people from Europe, and they can't get visas, and because they can't get visas, they're not coming to Britain, and that means that we can't get the trucks and things moving around the forecourts and all that. But the trouble with that argument for me is that after all, Brexit happened, well, almost a year and a half ago, more than a year and a half ago now. So why has this problem suddenly become such a problem today, after all these months? And it wasn't a problem until fairly recently. And I'm going to give my own guess here. I think there's an awful lot of profiteering going on. I think we're seeing energy prices shooting up in every direction. We're seeing oil prices are rising, they're surging, they're around $80 a barrel. We see the gas prices across Europe surging. We're seeing liquefied gas prices surging. We're seeing all of these problems, and I think some of the oil majors are looking at this and they're saying this is our opportunity. So we're going to reduce the amount of fuel for people's cars, and that will crank up prices even more. And as I said, I think there's an element of profiteering in this. That may sound a very cynical explanation, but as somebody who has, let's put it like this, historic acquaintance with oil companies, I'm perfectly ready to think that I have reasons for doing so. I mean, I've had dealings with them in the past. I mean, business dealings with them in the past, and I'm absolutely sure that there are people there who are perfectly capable of making these kind of calculations.
Okay, the interesting part that I gathered from your explanation was the fact that they're using this as a Brexit
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
wedge issue.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Germany's Olaf Scholz said the end of freedom of movement, the end of freedom of movement fueled the UK petrol crisis. That's a direct quote. What do you make of
Yeah.
that?
Well, absolutely. I mean, as I said, all the people who oppose Brexit are coming out and saying that. They've been saying that all over the place. I mean, if you read the media or follow the television, they're full of this. And I'm not going to say there's no truth to it at all. Undoubtedly, there is a shortage of drivers, and it isn't just affecting fuel that goes to, you know, garages, to gas stations. I mean, there's been elements of that also. You see shortages of some food deliveries and things of this kind. But this particular problem has sprung up so suddenly and so fast that I'm pretty sure that it's not connected entirely or even mainly to the problems of drivers. It's almost entirely, I am sure, related to problems with the energy shortages, worldwide energy shortages and rises in energy prices, which, by the way, I'm quite convinced are principally caused by the absolutely reckless overspending that's going on in the United States. That's another topic. We can talk about that another day. Oil companies, let me be absolutely clear about this, are very organized about getting fuel to the gas stations. And they would certainly have been aware of problems in the movement of, of petrol and diesel fuel for a long time. And they're exactly the kind of people who would have known how to prepare for it and who would be able to pay drivers and who would, if there'd been real problems, have known how to lobby government and how to get visa restrictions lifted for drivers. I mean, they are extremely well organised about this kind of thing. The fact that they didn't do it and that they haven't done it suggests to me that they actually are not unhappy to see this. That they did something very similar, by the way, against Tony Blair way back in 2000 when there was problems about taxes on fuel, and the oil companies weren't happy about that, and they held back fuel, and there were some people protesting outside the refineries. And they pretended that it was, in fact, the people who were protesting outside the refineries that were preventing them sending their lorries with the fuel on them to the stations, the gas stations. And that was, of course, again, the story that the media followed. But again, if you know anything about oil companies, you will know that that just doesn't make any kind of sense. And the same is true of this incident, of this episode also. As I said, it's very cynical, what I'm saying. I'm sure it's true. And I can tell you for an absolute fact, you're not going to read it anywhere in any part of the British media.
So to sum it up, are the oil companies sending a message to Boris Johnson, to his government?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, is this a message that they're sending to him? And how do the Tories react? How do they get past this? Because I'm reading articles and analysis which is saying that this could last until well into the Christmas season and beyond.
Yeah, absolutely. So they are giving him a message. First of all, I mean, they do want visa restrictions on drivers that they bring in from Europe East, and they've got it. I mean, he's already capitulated to them on that. And I mean, that's going to happen. And in future, they will also, I mean, because there's been big increases in taxes in Britain. I mean, we've talked about this already. They do not want fuel duty or anything like that increased. They don't want taxes on them. So they are giving him warnings and messages. But at the same time, don't discount the element of profiteering in all of this too.
Hmm. How does he get past this though? What do they do? Can they do anything? Because this must hurt his government. I mean,
well, it's not a good look. Well, it's not a good look at all. I mean, he can bring out the army, and that's to some extent what he's doing. He can get drivers from the army to, you know, drive around these lorries with all the fuel, and that's the latest story. And you know, we've been reading about all of this. My experience of doing that is that it's never a substitute. It doesn't really solve the problem because there's never enough drivers from the military that you can deploy to do this sort of thing. So I suspect that what's going to happen is that he is going to do a deal with the oil companies, and you will see that they will get what they want with visas for drivers from Europe, and that's a deal that will be done over the next few weeks.
Isn't there something that he could do to make the requirements to licensing easier for drivers, for locals, or there's just not enough demand in the UK market for that, or?
Well, working conditions for long haulage drivers in Britain, it's fair to say, have deteriorated over many years. And I'm going to say it again, this is going to be controversial, but I've no doubt at all that one of the reasons it's deteriorated is because so many companies in Britain have not felt any need to provide good conditions for long haulage drivers because they've just imported cheap ones from Europe, from Eastern Europe, who are prepared to accept far tougher and worse conditions than British drivers could. And the British government can do lots, actually, to turn that round. And if it works hard and it does a real programme, I mean, you know, one of the major things, I mean, I know people who've been long haulage drivers, I should say. Again, I've had to work with people like that in the past. One of the major issues, apart from pay, which is always an issue, is to also provide people like that with proper rest stops. That's declined to an unbelievable extent in Britain over the last few years. The government can do lots of things, but that, of course, is something that takes time. I mean, it would take, you know, a couple of years, not a huge amount of time, but it would take time. And, of course, Boris has to deal with the problem, the immediate problem now.
Final question, does this at all help Boris's competition in the Conservative Party, i.e. Sunak and the other coalition at all? Does this benefit Labour?
Right, OK, let's start with Labour. Now, Labour, it seems to me, is in an absolute and complete mess. They're having a shambles of a party conference at the very moment when Britain is in the grip of an energy crisis, when people are worried about their fuel bills. And, I mean, we've just talked about the fuel at the gas stations. We haven't talked about the fact that there's a general shortage of natural gas for heating, and there might be problems with heating this winter. That's a connected issue, but also a separate one, because it's not oil companies there, it's all sorts of other things. At the very time when all of this is happening, Labour is busy fighting each other. They're coming up with all sorts of intricate procedural changes that are of interest to no one at all. And the Labour leader, Keir Starmer, has published a long article setting out his beliefs, which nobody, frankly, is able to read through. And if you do read through it, you won't find any real clue of his beliefs there, because, to be frank about it, he doesn't seem to have any. So Labour is a mess, and I don't think anybody really sees them as a serious rival to the Conservatives at the moment. They might see an uptick in the polls, but that will simply be because the Conservatives are going to lose some support over this. So where do people go? They go to the Labour Party. But the moment things adjust, you see the Labour vote fall again and the Conservative vote rise. That's the reality of it. So within the opposition, the formal opposition, there is none. But you're absolutely correct in saying that for Boris, the problem is not the Labour Party. It is the factions, the hostile factions within the Conservative Party. And there he most emphatically is vulnerable. Sunak is still there. He still probably wants to be Prime Minister. He's still probably the prime contender of the adversary faction. Boris wasn't able to sack him in the latest reshuffle. He's not strong enough to do that. So Sunak is there. There are all sorts of people in the media who are still there, Tory media, the Conservative media, who are prepared to support Sunak. Boris absolutely has to worry about this. And, of course, this whole affair plays to the narrative. And I'm afraid it's, in many ways, a justified narrative that he's a bad manager, and that Britain now needs a strong manager to get it through its various problems. I do actually happen to agree. I don't think Boris is any kind of manager. Trouble is, I don't think Sunak is any sort of manager either. So, I mean, I don't take that particular criticism very seriously, because I don't think it's a case of you replacing a bad manager with a better one. I think you're going to replace one bad manager with another bad manager. The only real difference is that Boris is committed to Brexit and Sunak is not, or at least not to anything like the same degree. So that's the real issue. That's the real dividing line. But you can certainly see how that could be used as part of these factional battles that take place within the Conservative Party.
All right. Fascinating story. Guys, we will leave it there. TheDurad.locals.com. Check us out there and go to the Durad shop 10% off. Use the code REALNEWS. You'll find that down below. And follow us on all our other new media platforms, Odyssey, BitChute, Rumble, and SuperU. Take care.